Right. Good morning, everyone. So the EuroBSDCon Foundation is happy to present Mark Espy, who will be presenting to us about near-perfect packaging lists.
So. Thank you, Jesper.
Welcome.
I also like to thank the EuroBSD Foundation for inviting me, well, paying for the hotel and everything. Beautiful sunsets here, as you can see. So this is work I've done on OpenBSD. It's probably not applicable per se for other BSDs. For you might use some of the ideas for, say, getting better packing list in NetBSD and FreeBSD, because there are algorithmic parts which are interesting. And there are also implementation details that obviously you won't be able to reproduce exactly since we are using Perl. I wanted to start with something slightly different. I don't know if everybody is aware of that yet, but LLVM pulled a dirty trick on us. They changed their license from BSD, basically, to Apache V2. They were somewhat quiet about it. Some people know about it, but well, it's way too late to change things. But it's a bit like the FSF and GCC and GPL V3 all over again. Like, at some point, if we really want to stand for something and be BSD, we should probably speak up and tell them that we don't like that. Because once again, for OpenBSD, it means that the base compiler is going to stay stuck at LLVM 8, and we're going to have to use everything in ports all over again. So if you don't care about it, that's fine. But if you want to keep political things BSD, you should speak up about it if you can. Thank you. Yeah. So a bit of context first. We inherited 20 years ago everything from FreeBSD, well, that part at least. At some point, Theo decided that it was good to actually have binary packages that work. So we moved from the traditional way to do things, like you build, you install, you create the package from that, you try to install it on another machine, and you discover that it doesn't work because you missed some files, obviously, to what's called in our system stage installs, where you put everything in a specific location on your system that's unrelated to the running system, and then you do your package from there. We call that fake at that time. Maybe stage would be a better name, but we did it first, so we got to choose that name. Obviously, in order for that to work, you need to have some kind of manifest list to decide what goes into package. It was generated with somewhat stupid tools at the time, like the first version of things was just 150 lines of Perl. Just look under the local file system, figure out which files are new, and create the packing list from there. Moving to the staging area idea made things much faster, because instead of scanning through the whole file system, you only need to scan for the things that you just installed. So basically, you just need to copy every file name and a few things, annotations which look about nothing like what we have these days. Like, you used to have to say explicitly that you need to rerun ldconfig to get libraries and shit like that. And on the other side, at that point, package create was a bit of a mix between directly reading the packing list and also using sed to generate stuff. We soon got rid of that shit, specifically because it's not does not have any semantic meaning. Like, you can put anything in your packing lists, and package create is basically unaware of what's going on, so it's going to fuck up about every time. Sed is definitely a bad programming language. Sed, M4, CPP, all that shit. If you can put it in the trash bin and do better stuff, it's always a good idea. So about at that point, I decided to finally replace the old package tools from FreeBSD. Mostly for security reasons, because doing stuff that's supposed to be secure and that handles lots of character strings is more or less insane. Well, I mean, you can do it if you have lots of developers that are going to peek at about everything, and even then you'll get bugs. So we decided to take it up to a more modern programming language, and since we had Perl in base, I decided to do it with Perl. Perl is actually a pretty modern programming language when you know how to use it and you can do object-oriented stuff. So instead of having a flat structure for packing lists, I have a fully object-oriented one where you've got the basic element. No cats in the room? So you got the basic packing element stuff, base class. And then you have some subclasses that correspond to everything that you can put in your packing list. Like, for instance, here you've got just a part of the hierarchy, which is that objects are basically stuff that actually should exist in the file system, which have a current working directory where you can put absolute files, for instance, for configuration files, but not for anything else. Where you actually have methods that can compute the full name from what's in the packing list, etc., etc. And then, based on that, you have even more specific behavior. Like, for instance, a library for us these days is an object in that hierarchy that's just annotated in some cases so that, okay, I've seen a library in that directory. So later on, before I run anything, I will need to make sure that that library is registered with the system. So that way, we got rid of almost every single snippet of shellcode that used to exist to support packing lists. Everything is done through that directory hierarchy these days. That object hierarchy these days. So I added stuff to make playlist to let it be able to cope, and it grew to 300 lines for libraries and stuff, and also annotations like owner, modes, everything. Still fairly reasonable. Then we got flavors and multi-packages. If some of you are not too familiar with OpenBSD, flavors, they're just a way to record options into packages, but that means that in some cases you're going to get some specific fragments that say, okay, that part won't be in that specific version of a package because it's only, say, X Windows client, and we are building stuff with a GUI, for instance. And because you could have flavors within flavors and shit like that, I had to get rid of all the said stuff, and now these days, Package Create is able to read everything directly. It has a kind of small preprocessor that's very limited and that's only used to expand variables and read fragments. So, for instance, this is a modern packing list. I took something from one of my own ports. This is NetHack. And you see variables, you can get them about anywhere. You see also annotations, like the following files are going to be setuid, setuid, that's it. And then you get back to normal mode and shit like that. And here, you've got this specific marker that says that there is an adjunct to this packing list that's only used when you are not building the package with a NoX11 flavor. Pretty straightforward, right? Except that you have to get make playlist to understand this. And becomes a bit tougher because of the variables, because of the fragments and everything. So you also have multi-packages. The idea is that since the OpenBSD team is a bit small, we need to compile once and package several times. Like, for instance, instead of having to take apart a makefile to say, I only want to build this specific plugin for Qt, we build everything at once, like you build the wall of Qt around with Postgres, around with SQLite, around with everything. And then you separate it into several sub-packages that you don't need to install all at once. It actually makes things much simpler for porters, in theory at least, because you don't have to decide how you are going to split things up during the build process. You only need correct packaging information. You see the problem, because obviously it makes things simpler to build, but then I'm left with a problem of having a MakePaley script that's going to be able to sort through everything and put the files in the right location. So here's another old example, like this is UNU, the stuff that used to be used for Japanese people to enter stuff. And it has support for several languages, like Chinese, Japanese, Korean. And this means that you've got lots of sub-packages. Okay, so those are just the command for each package, and the full list, and the package name for each of them. That's very simple, very straightforward. The part that's not so straightforward and complicated for doing packing list is that stuff actually doesn't install in the same location for everything. Like you have the actual binaries that goes under local base as usual, but the dictionary proper are going to go into some subdirectory of variable. So this means that in order to support that, you need to extend MakePaylist so that it can take lots of options, because you have to get the correct environment for each package, and that includes different prefixes, possibly, for various sub-packages. So we're probably around 2012 or something like that, and MakePaylist has grown to about over 1,000 lines, and frankly, it's a mess, it's a complete mess. Like, you've got a list of variables that don't make any sense. Percent in Perl, those are for hashes. This means that you have every variable, more or less, which is duplicated for each sub-package in a multi-package. You've got the option parsing, which is completely crazy. Like, instead of having simple options, you've got options that can possibly be suffixed by the sub-package name. And, well, this is what you get when you take a somewhat simple program and you try to grow it until it breaks, more or less. Yeah, even the comments don't make any sense. Like, I actually had a data structure called a haystack, which is just a jumble of things that we put on the side and we're going to try to find files in there. It doesn't work all that well. Yeah. So it was time to sit and think about it, more or less. And after much thinking, because, yeah, everything was getting bad. The thing is, you've got this bad smell, which is that when you've got a tool and when you notice that each new thing you try to implement that should be easy actually gets more and more complex as time progresses, because you have to consider everything, then it's probably time to throw everything away and start over from scratch. Yeah, this was the situation at that point. Kind of works, but, you know, it's probably the most crappy code that I had in the tree at that point. So it was time to get rid of everything, and around 2015, I guess, I decided to stop implementing new stuff. I told people, no, this tool is probably no longer supported. I won't be adding anything to it. And of course, people did need to do stuff. So perfectly reasonable people like Stuart starting having their own scripts on top of MakePaylist to do things correctly for complex situations like Python, for instance. We'll talk about that later. So it was really, really bad, actually. I admit that I kind of messed up on that one because it took me 3.5 years to actually replace the old tools. The main problem is that the basic framework was quite simple. I knew exactly what I wanted to do and how I wanted to do it. But there are actually lots of special cases in the old make playlist. So the basic framework of replacing everything was done in about 2 or 3 months, something like that. And then I had to sit down and look at everything that the old tool was doing and figure out a way to do the same thing in a better way. And that's what took a lot of time, especially since, I wasn't only doing this. I was doing this as a long-running job, but obviously had requests from various developers to implement various things, to think over shit like DPB and stuff. So it took much longer than it should have. I have no idea how I should have done better, but I definitely know that I fucked up a little bit. So as for the design, there was stuff that was done in a wrong way at the beginning that I could do in a much better way now. For instance, the old make playlist predated moving package create to Perl, and it had to parse options in its own way. But the new package create, again, is also object-oriented Perl. So this means that instead of doing my own option parsing, I could just take the few methods that I have in package create and reuse them directly for update playlist so that I didn't have to change parameters. I could just use the exact same parameters that I use for package create and just literally reuse the code from package create to do my option parsing. The very cool point about this is that now, if I want to implement new stuff in package create, more or less, update playlist is going to get about 3/4 of the way there automatically. I don't have to do anything. It's going to work just as is. Well, of course, I still need to generate the packing list, but the option parsing, just down. Nothing to do. It will work. So, of course, you have to not get mixed up, because when you are running update playlist, you've got two levels. You've got the level of the update playlist thing proper, which has its own state. And then for each packing list that you want to create or recreate for multi-package setting, you're going to have a specific state for that packing list. The actual code looks like this. I didn't take anything out. So in order to process the next package, we're going to create a new playlist reader. That one is just going to have the global state somewhere, and the local state for this package is going to handle the options by itself. There is some maintenance stuff that says, okay, I have a full list of playlists. I just need to say that for this package, this is the old packing list, the stuff read from the disk, and this will be the new packing list that we generate. And then I actually call the code from package create to read the fragments, to ring the packing list. It's the exact same code, nothing changes. And then when I'm finished, when I've done this for every sub-package, I'm done. I just have my data structure. I don't have to do anything in make playlist that's actually different from package create for reading existing packing list. And that's cool. So afterwards, the global structure of the new tool looks like this. First, I read the old packing list. Then I process what's in there in order to decide which files and which directories I know. The idea is that if you have a multi-package structure, from time to time, when you update your packages, you're going to have new files and new subdirectories. We actually don't have any specific support for that. Like maybe you would say, OK, I want to say that if something follows that specific regular expression, then it's going to end up in that package. Nope, we don't need that. We just look at what was there. And if we've got a new file, we say, it lives in that directory. That directory was actually owned by that package, so it's going to end up in the same location. And that's quite enough for 99 cases out of 100, more or less, as far as I know. Then we actually do the scan of the file system with a somewhat more advanced scanner, but it's more or less fine, plus look at some file names, plus possibly run some code, like objdump, for instance, to figure out whether this is really a library or whether it's just something that masquerades as one, for instance. We actually copy the objects that we know about in the correct packing list, since now we have everything from the file system and everything from the old packing list. And missing tags, it's because you have some stuff that does not really exist in the file system. I'll give you some examples later. Like, for instance, configuration files. You usually have a sample configuration file somewhere, and you want to install it under /etc. And in that case, you get a sample annotation, and that stuff doesn't exist in the install directory. You have to just say, OK, this sheet should tag along the file that it's supposed to sample. Plus a few details to finish, because you know everything lies in the details. You still have to fix everything at some point. So that's it. What you have here is the full list of what update playlist does these days. Let's talk a bit more about the preprocessing part of package create, because that's really the interesting part. You have variables in there, and you have files on the file system, yeah, paths. And you actually want to be able to figure out whether there was a variable that was used for that file that you want to use all over again. So I actually changed a bit package create to support update playlist. Yeah, I know. There's just one single line in package create that says, OK, I've read this line from a file, from an actual packing list, and I'm going to substitute variables. The cool thing is that I can actually store both versions for update playlist. I can actually say, OK, I've got the full path with everything substituted correctly, and I also have the unsubstituted version where you still see the variables, so that you can stay consistent. Like if someone has used some variables in their packing list, you're actually going to keep those variables and not have to do any guesswork in most cases, because you already have all the information in the stored packing list. This is probably the most complex part of the new update playlist. It's called reverse subst. The old version in the old makepack playlist was a complete mess. Like you had to sort your variables by hand, say, OK, I'm going to put this variable first, so it's going to be reverse substituted first, and then the other one. The new one actually takes a global approach. Like first, what we do, which works very well, is to take each variable contents and sort them by length. So that, for instance, if among your variables you got something that says lib/python3/something, it's fairly long, so it's probably going to be picked at first for reverse substitution. And then if you've got a much shorter variable, like just the Python version that expands to 3, then it's almost never going to be seen because you've got a longer variable first, which is cool. And this is the place where everything does not quite work automatically. So we actually have some specific options to avoid stupid substitutions. Like, for instance, you can have variables that substitute only at the start of paths, like slash etc, for instance, because you've got lots of etc in the middle of paths otherwise. Also, suffixes for files, like Python compiled files. Doesn't happen all that often, but to be safe. Some variables that are so difficult to do automatically that actually we won't ever add them to an existing packing list. We will still keep them if they're already here, obviously. And even we have variables that expand to nothing. Which is a bit weird because you've got this path and at some point you're going to decide, okay, I want to introduce a variable in the middle of there or keep it there if it's already there and whatever. That's more or less Python. That's the big problem. It's only there because of Python. Whenever we finally get rid of Python 2, that would be a nice day. So this is how Python looks. Sorry for the small font, but the full line wouldn't fit otherwise. Like, you've got several fun things in there. Like modpy pycache is one of those variables that can actually expand to nothing. I don't remember whether it's on Python 2 or Python 3. I guess that Python 3 is probably more complex. So you probably have a cache on Python 3 and not on Python 2, something like that. And you even have that sheet, line number 4, which starts with a variable that actually expands to comment. More specifically, package create is pretty picky about things. Like, for instance, if you have twice the same directory, it will just simply refuse to create the package. And you can see how this works, because here you've got this stuff with, which will expand to nothing because of modpy pycache. And so this is the exact same directory as the directory on line 2 on some version of Python. So in that case, you have to add a comment so that one of the directories is going to vanish. And in the end, I actually wrote some specific codes in update plist to be able to handle that. That says, okay, you've got this variable which expands to nothing or a comment, depending on the Python version. And whenever you see twice the same directory, you should actually add that variable at the top so that you don't have duplicate entries in your packing list. It's actually fairly straightforward. It looks like this, more or less. At the last point before I actually write stuff to the resulting packing list, I just check if the entry I'm trying to write might be a candidate for comment, and if I have actually seen it already, then this one is going to transform into variable for comment, the actual directory name. So it happens automatically. You don't have to do anything. Modpy comment is supposed to come into play without you having to do anything. How much time do I have left? 15. Okay. Just one time. So the modpy comment that expands to nothing. Also, we got some specific stuff to handle local base and prefix, because both variables, most of the time, will expand to the same thing. And in case you have a prefix in your packing list, which sometimes happens, You don't want it to be replaced by local base or for update playlist to say, it's ambiguous, I don't know which one to choose. So it will always prefer prefix to local base, in fact. Let's talk a bit about the file system parser. It's not that complicated. More or less, you take any entry in the file system and you're going to pass it through a list of recognizers, a bit like brokers, you know. And the first recognizer that actually says, OK, this is something that I can handle, you stop there. Fairly straightforward, just simple object-oriented structure so that you can add to it. Right now, everything is centralized into make playlist, but I could actually say, OK, you can extend it if you want for specific tag types. We didn't do it that way because of the extra complexity for nothing. It's just simpler to have everything in one single location. But in theory, if you want to make this extensible, it's already extensible, more or less. So each object in the file system is going to have its own type, like libraries, like even some files that won't really map to specific types in the packing list. I'll talk about that later. The cool thing is that you can even have some specific behavior for some objects when you are doing substitution of variables. Like in OpenBSD, we've got this whole mechanism where we take control of every library SONM and version numbering, because it changes when you change compiler, obviously, so we can't let upstream do things for us. And this means that you've got lots of various variables that expand to almost nothing, like just a version number, see? But these variables have specific names, and because we know the type of the libraries, we will only consider one of these variables for the specific library that we want to substitute. So you can do this kind of magic. It's specific to OpenBSD, but you could adapt it to about any system. There's also a bit of code specific for resolving symlinks, because when you do your stage install, everything is going to point to nowhere, because the symlinks refer to the final installed location without the destination directory, so you have to actually resolve things by hand in order to get to the actual file. For performance reasons, recognizers may leave data around, like if you are running object dump to figure out file type, and object dump tells you that it's not the right file type, like, okay, this is not an executable but a shared object. Let's keep that information for later so that we don't run object dump all the time for the full file system. That's about it. That's very straightforward code. This part is very easy to, well, in my opinion, it's fairly easy to read and fairly easy to change if you need it. The last thing about perfect packing list generation usually is how do we sort through everything? The thing is, in many, many cases, you're not talking about an original port, but you're talking about updating something. And the bigger it is, the more painful it is to update. So you might want to wait for a bit, and then changes accumulate, and you realize that it's complicated to build. And part of the file structure changes, and with the old tools, it was even more horrible, because you would end up with a packing list that didn't make any sense that you had to fix by hand. So these days, it's much better. But more or less, I decided that I wanted to keep things sorted based on actual file names. Like, for instance, if you introduce variables in your packing list, it won't change the order of anything, because it's usually what you want. You want to be able to compare the old packing list with the new packing list, and that's really important. This leads to some amount of jitter for Python, for instance, because if you have packing list generated for Python 3 and you regenerate it for Python 2, the file names are going to change. So obviously, the sort order is going might be completely different. You also have stuff that is position dependent in the packing list. Basically, when you read the original packing list, you just look at stuff like option no comment and shit like that. Sorry, option no checksum and shit like that, or sample, and just put it in the right location because it should tag along with this file. And update playlist is going to tell you, OK, I've seen this sample, but I don't know what it corresponds to anymore because this file is no longer there, so you will have to do something. That's the 1% that doesn't work. Another example of an actual packing list. This is part of PHP. So you see you got lots of variables everywhere. You also have some state annotation, like which group you're going to install stuff as. There was a choice to make, like whether I'm going to try to group things together according to ownership or group things together according to the file system. I decided to go with a simpler approach, which is to keep the file system structure straight. And well, if there are lots of modes and owner annotation, that's it. It's not really a problem. It's still possible to read through it. And you've got an example of sample, for instance, which is going to tag along as near as it can to wherever it should be. Comments are somewhat tricky because they might correspond to files or they might not correspond to files. Like you've got this sheet that gets installed and you actually don't want it in your packing list. So you usually keep them sorted along with files if they correspond to files. So things might jitter a bit. This is the most annoying part about the new tools. But I've actually run it in most cases. And since I have big machines to test things on, I was actually able to regenerate every packing list from every port and check more or less that everything works. And then waited for my fellow Bennies to check that everything actually worked. Few details. I did some tag system for specific files recently, and it was very easy to add to update playlist. So I guess that for now, this tool might be good for another 5 or 10 years. I don't know. Maybe. It looks like it should work. And there are also some new improvements, like we are now actually building packages as a separate user. So update playlist was ready to be actually privilege separated. The file system scanner runs as pre-built. The code run as the user that's going to write stuff in the package directory. And as a bonus, we can even run package locate so that when you are generating a new packing list, it's going to tell you, OK, this actually conflicts with the existing packages, and that's it. So I guess this is about all. I'm just going to finish on a slide which is completely different. It's a side project that I did with OpenBSD. We actually have nice background pictures these days, thanks to fellow developers. So if you look it up on GitHub, you can use it on anything, even non-OpenBSD if you want. And we've got 500 nice pictures, like stuff from Chris Taps, for instance, who does take diving pictures. Stuff from Kirill Bichoff, who did lots of stuff in the north, and even some from Theo that took some convincing, but he did some fun stuff. OK, so that's it. You have any questions? Use the mic, please.
Surely it must be questions.
Have I lost everyone? Maybe?
If not, well, thank you very much, Mark.